Hi there, Guy from Bugs and Stuff here. In this video, I'm going to show you my method for breeding the blue death-feigning beetles. Blue death-feigning beetles have become increasingly popular as pets over the past few years, but until recently, their captive breeding has remained a bit of a mystery. For some reason, I find them quite easy to breed, and I thought I'd share my findings to promote captive breeding. Most of the beetles found for sale are currently wild caught. These small beetles hail from southwestern parts of the USA, so are mainly a desert scrubland species, and this should be taken into consideration when setting up their enclosure. Enclosures can be as elaborate as you want, and many people go to great lengths to provide a nice display tank. But here's my setup. Mine aren't really on display, with only a shallow substrate mix of cocoa fibre, topsoil and sand. A piece of cork bark for a hide, sliced fruit such as apple for moisture, and fish flakes and bee pollen as food. The apple slice is replaced every few days, and there's always food available. I keep my animal room at around 28 degrees Celsius, and apart from the moisture source, the substrate is kept bone dry. My tank is kept on a shelf in the animal room, and I don't provide any special lighting or have a basking hotspot. If anything, they are always away from bright light. So why are they called death-feigning beetles? Pick one up and it becomes obvious. First off, sexing your beetles. Apparently, they can be sexed by comparing each beetle's antennae. Males have more bristles on the underside of their antennae compared to females, but initially I never sexed any of my first group, just housing around 12 beetles all in one tank. I've tried this sexing method, but to me it wasn't obvious. If you're lucky enough to get pupa, there's a much more accurate way of sexing them, which I'll talk about later. So, my method. As I said, there's no special setup, no special temperatures or humidity, no basking spot or lighting, and in my experience, they're more nocturnal in habit, so I suspect they are too in the wild. I've only observed actual mating a few times, and I have no idea how many females and males I have. Eggs are small and laid directly into the substrate. Some people remove these from the substrate and try to rear them on. I don't. Every few months I will sieve out the substrate, and more often than not, this will reveal grubs of varying sizes, much easier than trying to rear the tiny eggs. So the eggs are laid in the substrate, hatch and start to grow in the same container as the adults. The grubs feed on the fish flakes and the bee pollen that is always in the substrate and gain moisture from the apple slices too. I've never witnessed any cannibalism with the grubs, but it may well happen, especially if they don't get enough protein from their food source. I've never seen an adult beetle feeding on a grub either, but again, it may happen. Once separated, I return the smaller ones to the adult's tank to continue growing, but I keep the larger grubs and move them on to the next stage. Grubs go through several molts as they grow, but it's only when they're in their final stages that I separate them. At this stage, the grubs are kept individually and their setup changes. Each grub is placed inside a small plastic tub. The lid is cut away to provide much needed ventilation, as they like to remain dry in my experience. Substrate can be used at this point, but I don't find it necessary. A very simple setup, as you can see. A small amount of fish flake and bee pollen as food, and again a small amount of apple for moisture. I then cut out circles of paper towel to give them some cover, and used another piece to cover the hole in the lid. Next, all the tubs are placed inside a homemade incubator. The tubs are then placed inside a tray, as some do climb out of their tubs, and this tray keeps them from escaping and burrowing into the polystyrene incubator. The incubator has a heat mat attached to a thermostat inside and is set to around 32 degrees centigrade. Inside the incubator, I place a small dish of water, as this keeps the humidity up a little, but not too much. Too much moisture is deadly for both adult beetles and the grubs. With the lid closed, they are in complete darkness, but there is a hole in the side for ventilation. I clean the grubs out about twice a week and replace the food, dried up apple and paper towel if needed, and that's it. Keeping it simple seems to work. The grubs eventually pupate, and at that point the tub is cleaned out and a fresh piece of paper towel is all that is needed. Sexing is best done at this stage, as there's obvious differences between males and females at the pupa stage, as can be seen in these images. It takes about 6 weeks for the adult beetle to emerge from the pupa, and at first it will be white and soft and takes around another week or so to dry out. At first they're reddish in colour before turning black and then eventually blue once they've fully dried out. Once they're black, I move these in with the other beetles, and that completes the breeding cycle. Although not 100% successful, I would say out of every 10 grubs, I get about 6 or 7 grubs through to adulthood. I have kept most of the captive bred beetles separate from the wild caught ones, as it will be interesting to see how long they actually live. There are records and reports that they can live in excess of 17 years. So there you go, my method for breeding these amazing beetles. Hopefully, with some refinement, I get my success rate to 100%, but for now, I'm happy to be able to share my findings with everyone. Thanks for watching.